All right. Well, hi, I'm April Bordeaux, and I am from Care to Change Counseling. Thank you for coming and joining and paying attention to this important topic about mental health of first responders and frontline workers and essential service personnel. I'm so glad that this is of interest to you. As we know, especially right now through COVID, there have been a larger impact, even more so than usual, on our frontline workers. And so this is an important topic for us as we want to build resilience and really move forward in our community planning efforts. So first, I want to really just give you some background information for those of you who may not be frontline workers or first responders, just to give you an idea. First of all, I want to share with you about the content of the job. Usually a first responder is someone, because of the name of their job, the name of their role, they're first on the scene. So they're the first ones to reach out if there's a disaster. All of the duties that they have are essential for the entire community. It's a strenuous type of first response because they do not know what they will see or encounter, or maybe even whom they might see or encounter. And so there's a lot of unknowns, which actually put them at an increased risk of trauma. So the content of their jobs, because of the unknown factor and being first on the scene, really places first responders at risk. There's a second element of their job that will make it strenuous for them, and that's the pace of the work that's being done. A lot of times first responders have such a fast-paced work that they go from one call to another call, and it's very highly stressful. The calls can be risky, and the tempo can really lead to an inability to integrate the experiences that they're having. One study shows that 69% of EMS professionals don't even have time to recover between traumatic events. And so as a result, you see higher levels of depression and stress and post-traumatic symptoms. We also see a large number of suicidal ideations and other functional and relational conditions that are reported in this group of professionals. Again, the content of their jobs are difficult, but the pace doesn't allow them to recover in between. So for those of you who are runners, for example, you know, as you're training for your mini or your marathon, that you have to pace yourself to not overwork your body. And so you have control over how quickly you run, when you take breaks, even in your training regimen. And when it comes time for a job like this, there isn't a time to pace, to create that intentional pacing. And if you are a runner, you know that if you don't take that break in between, that it can lead to a breakdown of muscles and you can actually be injured. And so that's the physical piece of what can happen if you don't lower the pace or slow the pace or be intentional about the pace. But for first responders, if the pace doesn't allow them to recover mentally, emotionally from what they've seen and experienced, and obviously it can lead to a breakdown in their mental health. So two elements, the content and the pace. The third element are also personal issues. Having someone's personal life affected by a disaster that they respond to can lead to higher levels of mental health issues in first responders. And if you think about COVID, there is not a person on the planet that has not been impacted by COVID in some way or another. There's a lot of distress placed on families. Depression rates are increasing. PTSD is increasing. Watching television, re-watching what has happened can also lead to greater risk and PTSD symptoms and distress. And so when there's a personal element, it increases. So you have what they do, you have the pace at which they're doing it, and then you add this element that they're impacted at home as well. So this combination makes it really understandable why first responders would be feeling a lot of distress at this point. People are afraid of dying, losing family members, infections. I mean, there's just so much risk and right now for anyone. And then you add this element of what it is that they're doing in their job, and you can understand. First responders and frontline workers, especially workers in the healthcare industry and law enforcement, in long-term care, they really play a crucial role in fighting and saving lives. But that exceptional stress that they feel, the workloads, the difficult decisions that they have to make right at the moment, and the risk of being infected, witnessing deaths, those kind of things. As you can imagine, even saying all of this and adding all of these different elements together, you can tell why someone would feel especially distressed. Then if you want to add, there's an element in first responders that's the culture. They have their own culture in the job of responding. And, you know, I know that I'm part of the crisis response team, and we have a job to do when we are called to help families and communities debrief. And so we are there to be helpers to the people who want and need that help. It's not for us to go in and ask for help. And so first responders often have the mindset that this is just when you thank a police officer, or you thank a doctor, you thank a first responder, they'll say something like, it's just part of the job. This is just what I get paid to do. This is just what I know. I'm not a hero. It's just my job. And so a lot of the culture of it's stigmatizing almost if they need to or want to reach out for help. And yet everyone who's listening, everyone who's watching this video, every one of us are human. And there has not been a point in our lives when we have never asked for help. We've all at some point in our lives needed help. That makes us human. It doesn't make us weak. And so going and being a first responder over and over and over, and having the pace and knowing the personal issues and threats that are lingering with COVID, needing help and wanting to respond is part of being human. It's not an indicator of being weak. And so there are two reports that I want to encourage anyone who's watching to go and read. One is put out by SAMHSA, and the other is put out by the World Health Organization. And both are about COVID and first line workers and how. And the one from the World Health Organization was actually just released in May of 2020, this just not too long ago. And so at least at this recording. So the question isn't, do we know if there's stress involved in being a first line worker, a first responder? We all know that. We don't have to be a police officer to know that there is stress involved. We don't have to be an emergency room doctor to know the amount of stress that's involved. We may not have experienced it the way that those in that profession have, but anyone can understand the amount of stress or the pace of that job and how that can take a toll on someone mentally. And even relationally, the question isn't, does it take a toll? The question is, what do we do about it? That's really the question. If you're watching today, watching this video, it's because you already know. You know that there is a lot of stress placed on this group of people. And there's no reason to try to convince anyone of that. We know that. The question really is, well, what do we do about it? What's our response to that? How can we help? What can we do to build them up, to create a space for them to recover in between incidents, so that they're at their best to continue to serve the way that they know how, the way that they've been trained. So I want to give you some tips on what you can do, both if you're a family member of someone who's a first responder, as well as if you are a first responder, and then if you are an employer for a first responder. There are three different groups of people, but we're all here to support our loved ones and our first responders and our employees. And so this can apply for all three groups. So what do you do? What do you do? The first element is to recognize the symptoms. If you don't recognize the symptoms, you continue to move on and do the job and do the job. And a lot of times it's not until our bodies get sick or our bodies break down in some way that we realize we need to pause and take care of ourselves. And so the first step in helping is to recognize the symptoms. And those are whether you're experiencing the symptoms or your loved one or your employee is. So what are some of those symptoms? If we were in a workshop right now, I would pause and say, tell me, audience, what are some of those symptoms? So in your mind, I'm going to pause talking and just identify what do you think some of those symptoms might be. So maybe we have behavioral symptoms, irritability, being agitated easily, being hostile, hypervigilant, which is like I have to be on all the time, not able to truly just relax. Behaviorally, we also see self-destructive behavior, and that would be using increased like numbing agents, smoking, food, drugs, alcohol, anything that sort of numbs the body from feeling the distress. So we see increased self-destructive behavior, social isolation. So just not wanting to be with people, needing to go home and be in the chair and click through the remote. Behaviorally, we see these behaviors as ways to cope with what it is that the body and the mind is experiencing. Psychological symptoms include flashbacks, fear in places that aren't usually part of fear, severe anxiety or mistrust of others, becoming a little bit jaded. I can tell a story about this. I work with a lot of families and have, you know, over the past 20 years that have been in crisis. And I went for a walk in a park with my family one day, and it was a Saturday. We were enjoying our time and came up to an area that you could overlook water. And so I was standing looking over the water, and the thought that came to my mind was, I wonder how many people have tried to die by suicide here. I wonder how many people have jumped. Well, that's not usually a normal thought that someone would have during a beautiful nature walk, right? But it was an indicator to me that if that was where my mind was first going, I probably needed to take a break from working with people that felt suicidal. And so it was an indicator to me, you know what, that's not common thought, but it's something that would come to my mind because I've been around it and helped people in that area so often. And so having thoughts that don't, you know, the common person wouldn't necessarily have in that same situation. You know, my family was enjoying the scenery and looking out and what, you know, really that's what it's there for. And so that's an indicator. You can also look at moods. There's loss of interest in things that used to be fun or pleasure in activities. Feeling guilt, maybe survivor's guilt is one, or guilt that maybe should I have done more in that situation. And loneliness, this feeling like I'm all in this by myself. Others don't understand. That can be a sign. And then we can talk about things like sleep, having nightmares, not being able to sleep, excessive sleeping, so a difference in sleep patterns. A common response is being emotionally detached in relationships, just having to separate from others. These are all, so behaviorally, psychologically, in our mood, in our sleep, and in our attachments and relationships. Those are all symptoms that someone might be experiencing too much stress or not having enough time in between requirements and responsibilities to really process what they've seen and experienced and to be at their best mentally for the next thing that's expected of them. So first stop, recognize the symptoms. Then what do you do? Well, I actually know the symptoms. That's why I'm on this call today. That's why I'm watching. I've seen these in my loved one, or I've seen these in my employees, or I've experienced them myself. Maybe you're already at that point. You know the stress of the job. You already know that you're experiencing symptoms now, or someone that you love is. Now, what am I supposed to do about it? So I'm going to give you 9 steps, and these are not steps to take as in do this first and then do this and then do that. That's not what these steps are. These are 9 things you can do in addition to recognizing the symptoms to actually helping those around you. So they're not in order, no particular order. These are just 9 things that you can do. The first is to create an environment of open communication. So promoting, protecting, and caring for mental health by communicating in ways that promote mental health and well-being. So making it common practice to talk about how it is that you're doing. Wow, that was rough. That shift was rough. You know, how are you doing with that? Without any sort of judgment. So you're just on in regular routine, making it an environment for openly discussing how the shift was or how someone is doing. So having open communication, it sounds simple, but a lot of times we go from one thing to the next thing to the next thing, and we don't pause and just recognize how it was. And so before we know it, we're irritable and we're having an outburst, and wow, it's not really about whatever it is the outburst is about. It's about holding all of what's happened in prior to. So the first thing is really just creating an environment where you can have open communication. The second is to ensure that there's availability of emergency mental health and psychosocial support. So what does that mean? Making it regular practice to let people know what resources are available. Going to see a counselor, talking with the team about debriefing, accessing your EAP, making those support systems readily available and known. A lot of times people don't know they have an EAP, and they're searching for even their, think about when, if someone in your family breaks their arm and you have to go to the emergency room and they ask you for your, you know, your insurance card, and you're like, oh, where did I put the insurance card? You're not thinking about that because you're in the middle of an emergency. So if you always know where that card is, or you put it in a place where you have access to it, then when you need it, you don't have to search for it. So it's that same concept, but with mental health. If people know what resources are available and it's just part of the norm, then when someone chooses to access that, that's not an extra frustration for them to actually find someone to help. So just make sure there's a widespread availability. And here's what I would say, you know, as a therapist, what I would say is not every therapist and every mental health organization works for everyone, which means there needs to be options available. You know, one person might really click well with one therapist and not with another. And so it's important that people know there are lots of different options available. The important thing is that they have those readily available. The third element way that you can support is really supporting community action. Any kind of community action that strengthens social cohesion and solidarity and healthy coping and reducing loneliness, promoting well-being, anything in the community that really strengthens and promotes this healthy living and healthy lifestyle, make that a part of your family or make that a part of your organization. So, or if you're the frontline worker watching this today, find out what healthy outlets are already available in the community to join. Are there running groups that you could join if it's you? If you're an employer, the Hendricks County actually has a mental health and wellness coalition that you're welcome to attend, to send people in so that you're current on what is available and have resources right there, and you have the relationships that are needed. So support that community so that those can continue and so that those relationships are already built. Another element that you can do is to provide access to remote support. So especially right now during this time of COVID, people have different schedules with family and driving and shifts, and also really just concern about, do I wear a mask? Do I not wear a mask? When do I go in public? When do I not go in public? And there's a great plan that's out, but people still have different levels of comfort with that. And so provide some sort of access so that they can get support through secure video sessions. So right now I'm using Zoom as the platform to record this and to share. There are HIPAA compliant secure video conferencing available. So as an organization, you can have a private room set aside that someone can access, or really anymore. All you need is access to the web. So you can even have this kind of call right here on your phone. So just making that available. I know I've heard that there are some hospitals that are putting, you know, private rooms on the side so people can go and debrief or prepare before and after shifts. And again, I would love to, if you're watching this and that's you, I'd love to talk with you about how that's going. My worry card with that is the culture and are people taking advantage of that opportunity. I sure hope that people are. That's a great idea. Another element is to protect and promote the human rights of people that already have mental health conditions. So if you're a loved one or your employee, you already know, has struggled in the past with anxiety or depression or maybe a substance abuse issue of some sort, when you add an element of COVID onto that, even if their treatment is right on in progress, you know, they're seeing their therapist or taking medication if that's part of their treatment plan, but they seem to be in a good space, something like COVID can trigger. And so that can put someone right back into needing to go back and access those support systems. So if you already know that your loved one or your employee has, you know, a mental health condition, and this can really put someone into it. You know, people have called us at Care to Change and said, you know, I thought my depression was sort of, you know, you say under control, which really isn't. It's really, you know, how do you get something under control? It's like you're managing it. You're thriving in life, knowing that depression is a part of life, but it doesn't have to consume. Well, something like COVID can bring that back up again. And so someone says, wait, I thought we were on a good path. I don't understand. Or anxiety, especially anxiety right now, and substance abuse is just being triggered. Or if someone has a history of trauma, adding this element of uncertainty into the daily life, it can really trigger some of the trauma responses. And that's a biological function. That's not, again, I want to really, really stress that it doesn't mean someone is weak. It means someone is human. So if you're, again, I'll use the example of running. If you're running for a marathon and there's an unexpected piece of pavement, or you're not prepared in some way for crowds or things, and you trip, guess what? That's a function of what's around you. That doesn't mean you're not a good runner. It just takes one moment taking your eyes off or not being aware. And so, and you would respond immediately because your body is asking for that. And mental health is the same way. When you're feeling depressed or you're feeling anxious or you're having some of those symptoms I've already discussed, that's another part of the body. It's an indicator light. And just like if you were experiencing swelling or, you know, from your run, you would address that, put ice on that for a moment so that you could get back to it. Mental health is the same way. It's just a different part of the body. So listen to that. Another tip, something that you can do is support recovery from COVID by building mental health services for the future. So organize affordable community-based services that are effective, that are protective of human rights. And so if you're not involved and you want to get involved, you can, but then think ahead. So it's hard right now because we're still sort of in the middle of COVID, but we have to look ahead. What is it that we're going to be doing in 6 months from now that's helping people with their mental health that we're not doing right now? We can't just let the days take over, because before we know it, you know, we've been in this at this point, at this recording, for about 3 months, at least in our area of the world, about 3 months that we've been actively, you know, fighting against and taking steps against the spread of COVID. And think about how fast the last 90 days have been. And so what do we want to be doing in 90 days that makes us stronger as a community and in our families and supportive of first responders that we're not doing right now. So right now is the time to put those in place. And I realize it's difficult because we're all tired and we're all doing things that are required of us right now. But to put that aside and not address it again, we don't want to wait until there's some sort of a breakdown before we respond. We want to support that recovery effort in whatever way that we can. And so I want to encourage you to reach out to, you can email me or someone at partnership and we can connect you to get involved in whatever way works for your family, whatever way works for your organization. It's really an individualized approach, but join what's already in progress. Now, another thing you can do, again, these aren't in any order, I'm just sharing ideas with you, include mental health care in your healthcare benefit packages. I mentioned EAPs, those are employee assistance programs. A lot of insurance companies have add-on benefits of mental health care. And so I want to encourage you, if you are employed, look at your health package benefits and ask your HR person, are mental health benefits included? And even if you don't need them, ask your HR department to consider including them because you know that other people do. So even if you're not an impact in any way, I want to ask you to advocate for those who would make use of those services. And if you are the HR person or you are the organization saying we really want to help our employees dust off your health insurance packages and your EAPs and review those to see what kind of benefits are available to people who really need it, especially now, so that those are available. So, and if they aren't included, you know, you can connect with Care to Change. We're happy to work with you through that process. Another tip is to adjust your staffing procedures and schedules where possible. So at the beginning, we talked about the content of the job, and then we talked about the pace of the job. If your people are doing 12-hour shifts day after day after day, and they get one day off, they get 2 days off, or especially the overnight shifts. Overnight shifts are difficult on a body. Because it sort of breaks the natural rhythm of the body to sleep during the night and to be awake during the day, even if you're a night person. I know this. I used to operate a 24-hour facility, and the overnight shifts are so difficult on a body. And so not that daytimes aren't, but there's for different reasons, the overnight shift. And so look at the staffing schedules and the staffing procedures and really hone in on what can you do to provide sufficient breaks between shifts so that people have a chance to go back to wherever their safe spot is at home, to relax, to bring their cortisol levels back down, to go back to a baseline, to really be secure for their next shift. And so look at those schedules and wherever possible. And if you are the person that's saying, I need help, well, I don't get to control my schedule. You know, I'm handed my schedule and I have to work 4/12s or whatever, 2/16s, whatever it is. You know, if you feel it and you know it's starting to really wear, my relationships are suffering from this, it might be time to just say, you know what, I want to be in this for the long haul. I love what I do. I love helping other people. I also know what this is doing to me right now. And so I need to talk about, are there ways to kind of change the shift or just make a few tweaks here and there just to give extra time? Maybe it's more breaks in between. Maybe there's a certain number of breaks in between answering calls. I don't know. Again, there's lots of different organizations that can be watching this. And so there's not a one size fits all. The important thing is to look at the staffing schedules and see if there is a way you can support your team by providing those breaks in between, whatever that looks like for you. And then the last element is really facilitating additional training for your frontline staff. There are some reports that show that the mental health first aid training really helps prepare and strengthen someone for what it is they're going to see. It also normalizes the fact that this is stressful. We don't have to carry a bravado around with us. if we know that, gosh, seeing someone in this condition, seeing another human in this condition, it is startling because it's human to human, right? And this is what we're talking about. We're talking about people. And so, yeah, it's normal and common to be upset by what you see when what you see is something that's disturbing. Of course, that's human nature. We want that. And so really just normalizing and providing that additional support can be helpful. People who say, oh my gosh, I'm not weak. That's just normal. Just having that assurance is helpful and beneficial. And letting people know these are signs, again, not that you're weak, it's signs that your brain is saying, hey, it's time for a break. That those are important. So I want to say those one more time, just so that in case you're taking notes and you missed one, or I'm talking without pausing and allowing people to ask questions like we would in a live recording. Creating an environment of open communication, ensuring there's widespread availability of mental health support, supporting community action that strengthens social cohesion in this, providing access to remote psychosocial support or therapy services, whatever you want to call it, protecting and promoting human rights where you already know there are mental health conditions, supporting the recovery of mental health services by looking at the future and planning accordingly, including mental health care in your health benefits, adjusting staff schedules as best as you can, and then facilitating additional training for frontline staff. These are all things that would be helpful. I hope that the information that's provided to you is information that's useful. What I want to say is if you have additional questions or comments or ideas, we welcome those at Care to Change. So feel free to reach out. You can reach out to me. Our number is 317-790-9396. You can also email help@caretochange.org. You can text us, whatever method of communication works best for you. I encourage you to reach out. Obviously, we're on social media, so you can follow us and connect with us through messaging and that sort of thing. Whatever works for you. We have a website that right now we have a tab for COVID resources, and that's where this will eventually be put on our COVID website tab. So, and there are other trainings that have happened during this time and during Mental Health Awareness Month. So lots of options, lots of support. We welcome your input. We welcome your comments. And if there's anything that we can do, please reach out. We are here for you. Thanks, everyone.